Hi, hello everyone. My name is Shane, and I work at Expedia Group. And today I'm going to talk about how we went through our GraphQL journey creating a federated schema. So we've already heard today about what a federated schema means and how that process looks like, some of the tooling that's going to be coming from Apollo to create new GraphQL schemas in a federated way. We kind of came at this approach a little bit before before Apollo had all these tooling. So we've been talking with Apollo through this process and how we've done our schema, and we've really kind of aligned in some of the areas. So you might see some overlap here, but I just wanted to talk about some of the challenges that we've had over the past 2 years doing GraphQL. So first off, I did say Expedia Group, not Expedia, you might have heard of. Expedia Group is actually a larger company, and we own a bunch of different brands you might have heard of. Some of them are Expedia, Orbitz, Travelocity, HomeAway, Vrbo, Hotels.com, Hotwire. All these different brands are under the umbrella of Expedia Group. And we actually have over 25 different brands that all kind of come together. And over the 22 years of our company, all these different brands have built lots of different technologies to provide products to our travelers. So we obviously have things like hotels, flights, we have activities you can book, car rentals, vacation rentals, so you can rent housing. And all these different teams and products were built by teams often in separate areas. We have teams across the globe in different countries, different offices, and it's a large communication process between a large company that we have to deal with. And so the whole company can be divided up into basically two large separate organizations. We have on the left here, we have our travelers who interact with our site, and then on the right, we have our suppliers, so that'd be the hotels and the airlines. They have to give us our data. So really, we have the shopping teams, which could provide the customer experience, and then we also have our supply teams. But today, I'm just going to be talking about the shopping side of things. So mostly, anything you've interacted with on our sites, you've probably seen powering those UIs. So the company scope for just the shopping teams is that we have over 500 developers across the globe, and that's just developers. That doesn't include our product managers, our managers of engineers, our designers. We're a very large company who manages these products that you interact with, and so this communication is very difficult, especially when you go across the globe, across time zones. We have to have meetings at different times with India. I work in Seattle, and that's not a very friendly time zone overlap. I've taken lots of 7 a.m. meetings. And we also have lots of API teams that power these different products. So we have different APIs to power the shopping products, like our hotels, flights, booking, customer data. All those APIs are managed by an entire team. And then we have the front-end clients or apps that are actually consuming that data. And we have over 50 different web pages that you might interact with, or our mobile apps like iOS and Android. We're onboarding new apps every day. And all these different apps have teams that manage them, and they all have to consume this data. So really, we started off this journey by taking a look actually at our customer experience. This wasn't really around GraphQL. It started off us looking at what the site looks like today and noticing that there's a discrepancy. As a traveler coming to any of our brands, you might see different colors, different data, whether you're using the mobile app or the website, and they're all kind of similar. We're all using yellow and blue on Expedia, and we're all using the other colors on different brands. But really, there's still some minor discrepancies. And so our first actual push for doing this kind of change was that we wanted to align the customer experience. So things like the filters and sort selection. So here on the left, right, we just have an option. You have the filters and pills. They come up on the top of the screen versus like on the mobile app, they're on the bottom. And you might think that, okay, sure, that's fine. But really, it should just be the same across all our apps and all our designs. And often, you might even get discrepancies in the data we show. So here, we have this concept of a message which would tell you that, hey, you're booking a hotel in Maui, and it's pretty heavily booked. You might want to book soon. That data doesn't even appear anywhere on our mobile sites because they're using a different API to get the hotel data. So we wanted to first align the customer experience, which also requires that we align the data. And so how did we get to this state of all these different experiences? Well, We have our different domain teams on the bottom here. We have hotels, flights, cars, et cetera. And they have all the clients at the top that we have to talk to, our progressive web apps on the web, our native apps, new Alexa and Google Home chatbots. And just like Matt talked about earlier, we had all these connections. All the connections between the clients have to be managed not only on the clients, but also on the server or on the service teams. So as a client, if I want to use some new data or expose a new feature to a traveler, I have to first know that this data even exists at Expedia. You have to know that there's this team somewhere producing this data because, again, we're a very large company. You might not know that that team is working on this product. But let's say you do find them, you find their product, now you have to work with their documentation. Maybe they're doing REST API this way, maybe they're doing JSON, maybe they're doing XML. Everything's different depending on the API you're interacting with. And then as a service owner, you also have to kind of do all this client management. If you have to deprecate a REST API or maybe an endpoint, or maybe even just an individual field on your API, it can be very difficult to like talk to every single client that's using your API and send out these emails saying, hey, we're going to turn it off. Like, you better stop using it. And just this cross-communication across a global company is very difficult. We started to kind of reduce some of this effort when we moved to a pattern known as a BFF, or backend for frontend. We started doing this for our mobile websites, specifically on the hotels page. So BFF just kind of gave us one entry point where the client could talk to this, the single endpoint. It's going to take care of talking to all those different services. So now the client can be pretty dumb. It doesn't have any business logic in it. And the data returned from the BFF would just be exactly what that client needed to power a UI. But if we wanted to roll this pattern out for everyone, we would have to essentially create a BFF for every single client. And that just really doesn't fix anything, because now we just have another service layer in between all the clients. We really needed a BFF for everyone. And again, if we want to align on the traveler experience, the UI, we also want to align on the data we're showing them. So that's where GraphQL came in. We realized GraphQL is exactly what needed to power this experience. If we have one entry point for our clients to talk to, they don't have to worry about all these client connections, managing these communications with these external teams. And then as a service owner, you know you can just expose your data into the schema, and any client who needs that data can consume it. You don't have to worry about managing these deprecations. You can just deprecate it in the schema, and you can just talk with the clients, and then we have our operation registry to look at exactly who's using it. But as I mentioned before, these hotel teams, the flight team, these are massive teams. I looked at just the other day the hotels API. We have over 150 developers contributing in just the past few months. So there's no way that we can have every single team contributing to a single schema. So this is where we almost immediately from the start knew we had to work with a federated schema model. So we have at the top here, actually, or in the middle, we have our hotel service. And so the hotels team can work on their own GraphQL service. They expose the schema because they really understand the hotel's domain. They know exactly the products and data they need to provide. And then all the different teams can provide their individual GraphQL microservices. And then the GraphQL gateway at the top can just look at these different services and stitch them together and expose still a single schema for our clients. But now the teams don't have to worry about conflicting and working in a single code base. So this is what's known as a federated model, which, again, a lot of the Apollo developers already have talked about here. We're not quite using the same tooling that they've mentioned, but I'm going to talk about the tooling that we are using. So how did we go from the REST API model to this GraphQL service? Well, it wasn't just in one foul swoop. We started with hotels, and then we started bringing new clients and new data on board as they started getting familiar with GraphQL and as we felt the need to start exposing that data. And this requires some technology changes. So our existing kind of stack was very heavily powered by Java. Most of our REST APIs are built on Java. We have lots of Java libraries that are actually still shared across all those APIs, and we needed to use those libraries. And a lot of the servers, a lot of these REST APIs, are built in different technologies. So some teams might be using Spring Boot, some teams might be using Drop Wizard. And if we're going to be creating these individual microservices, it was going to be kind of complicated if everyone got to use their own technology. And also, everyone was just doing different logging and metrics. So some teams were using different libraries. They were logging it in a different way. Some were using Splunk to log their data. Others were just using Grafana. All these tools that you might have heard of, everyone was doing something different. And we realized if we're going to really create this small microservice level to expose it, we wanted teams to have the simplest way to onboard onto that architecture. And so that required us kind of standardizing some of our tooling. So since we're pretty heavy on Java, we decided that we would use GraphQL-Java. This is just a server implementation of the GraphQL spec, so it allows you to expose a GraphQL schema using Java services. And then we actually built Kotlin on top of that. So Kotlin is a great language, it has some great features. And additional to creating the server, we actually built a GraphQL server SDK, if you want to call it that. We basically take care of standardizing everything that the developer would normally do to start up a new service, and just put that into a template. So now you just go to this template, you fork it, and then you get to just write your simple query on exposing your business logic. You don't have to worry about how does the server start up, what server technology we're using, what is the login monitoring metric library we're using. Everyone's going to do it the same way. And if we scale this across the company, it just benefits everyone, because now everyone's using the same tooling. Also, since now we have this SDK, how everything's built or everything is coded, we also wanted to standardize our CI/CD process. So all these tools kind of come together to make sure that everyone's doing the same thing. Because again, if we work in a large scale company like Expedia Group, we just wanted to have the best tooling available. And if there is something wrong with the tooling, if one person fixes it from the community, then everyone gets the benefits. So speaking of some of the tooling, we actually open sourced one of those parts of that tooling of the SDK, and that is GraphQL Kotlin. So right now, if you were to create a GraphQL Java service, you have to define your schema. You have to either do that with a schema file or using their kind of their Java templating, the way you kind of just define the schema. And then you have your resolvers, which have to implement that schema. And for us, we just noticed there was a lot of duplication, because now the types have to match and everything just, it gets a little complicated if you miss something. Yes, that can be checked in build time, but we just thought, hey, Kotlin is a great language. It has strong types. It has the concept of nullability, just like GraphQL. What if we could just generate the schema from your existing code? So that's exactly what we do. So GraphQL Kotlin just looks at like a function you expose, and it looks at the arguments, looks at the return type. And using reflection, we can just generate the schema from your existing code. So that's how we kind of enable developers to not worry about the server or the SDK or any of that. They just have to write a function, which is a query, and then that function just gets exposed in the schema. So feel free to check us out on GitHub. Again, that's GraphQL Kotlin. So since we're doing schema stitching, we have all these different services. One thing we had issue was with those conflicting types when we end up merging the schema. So if I'm in the hotels team and I define a type, like pretty generic type, like a coordinate, and I merge that into our schema, and that gets exposed into the global schema. If now the flights team wants to have some type called a coordinate, like a GPS coordinate, that's actually going to conflict when we do our schema stitching. And so we wanted to standardize some of the types that we're using across all our services. So this is where we have this concept of a shared type. So we just created a simple directive at shared. And this just kind of allows us to look at the schema when we're doing the stitching and know that the services that are exposing this type, this is actually coming from the SDK, and this is valid, this is not going to be a type conflict, and it's going to look exactly the same across all the services. And we didn't just do this for basic types like coordinates, we did it for things like our date and our time. So now if you're providing a date, it's going to be exactly the same format. You don't no longer have to worry, it's a date string, and is it month, month, day, day, year, year, or is it day first? What's the format? Everyone's going to use the same date object as these well-defined types. Same thing goes for like how we expose our money objects. Everyone's going to get the same format because we require everyone to pass in a locale. So now our SDK can take care of doing localization. So our money is always going to look the same across the site. But also, again, since we're trying to standardize the way our site looks, we have shared types around UI elements. So things like images. An image should always have a full URL and the text that we have for our accessibility. So every image exposed on our schema will always be the SDK image type. So how do we know that these types don't conflict in the schema? Well, like I said, we're using schema stitching. This is kind of our first approach on how we did schema stitching. We had our individual microservices down here at the bottom, and then we have to get them somehow to the gateway. So we actually used the Apollo schema stitching code that we talked about earlier, and we say, hey, let's just put this code in the gateway. We'll run some polling operation, and every 10 seconds, we'll just look at the services. If there's an update to the schema, we'll just merge the schema back together and redeploy the gateway. And this worked, but we obviously ran into quite a few problems. Polling takes a lot of resources. We just might have missed something if there was a misdeployment in like one AWS region, but not the other. So we pretty quickly realized we needed to change this model. And we now have this new model where at build time, when a change is made, it's already approved to a schema, like the hotel service, they push their schema to an S3 bucket. And that S3 bucket is just now being watched by some Lambda, which has our schema stitching code. And every individual service can have their own bucket or just some location which we understand. The Lambda notifies whenever a bucket update is made. It gets the latest version. And then it just stitches together the schema with our code and pushes out to another S3 bucket, which is the global schema bucket. So now we have this history of the schema as well. And then now the gateway can be notified with a push model instead whenever there's a new schema. And we can add more information into this pipeline. So now, since we build the schema at build time, we can publish metadata into the S3 bucket, like what was the SDK version this service was using, what was the Git hash, what was some of the other like Expedia-specific libraries that we were using when we built this schema, and just allows us to have more information whenever we do our introspection or look at into what services are doing. Also, since we are using Apollo tooling, we are pushing the schema whenever we do the stitching into Apollo Engine, and primarily just the schema registry. So Apollo provides a couple tools, the operation registry, schema registry, client registry, and really just any schema registry is going to be almost invaluable for us, whether it's Apollo or just building your own. But for us, having a schema registry has allowed us to do some of these validation things that we've mentioned already in some of these talks, right? So if we have this history or we have this knowledge of exactly what is in the schema, so a property or a hotel here has all these fields, we know exactly who's querying it because everyone has to go through the gateway. We know exactly what, how many times per minute this query is being used, what operations are being used, and what exactly the client names that are using this field. So if someone tries to check in a code change to a schema, and that schema change would either be breaking a client, or maybe you're just conflicting with a type name, an existing schema, we can fail you on in a PR check in GitHub. Right, so this is just almost invaluable for us because before we were trying to build this on our own, and as soon as we started using Apollo Engine, we're like, this is it. We wanted to have these checks in the pipeline here, and now we don't have to worry about checking it on build time or failing the deployment. Instead, we can do it like on PR time. So now that we have all these technology changes and we want to start bringing teams on to this concept of GraphQL, it's going to take a while. It took a while for us to start teaching everyone these new concepts, which requires this culture change in the company. Previously, teams were pretty siloed, so they used to work on their own teams. So the hotels team actually created their own APIs for shopping, but then they also created their own web apps. So they never talked with the flights team because they just worked on hotels, flights just worked on flights, and so on and so on. No one ever had this cross communication. But now, if we're going to be communicating across a single schema, that needs to change. So how do we have this change across our company culture? And the first thing we did was we kind of established these schema managers. So I work on the team of these schema managers, and our goal is to kind of build the tooling out for the company that we're using. So we've been working with Apollo to make sure that our teams get all the benefits and tools that they need to build the schema. But we also are kind of the gateway and the gatekeepers, per se, of the overall one schema at the top level. So as we're bringing more and more teams onto this global schema, we need to make sure they understand the process of what GraphQL means to them. And so we need to coordinate with them, make sure that they're following the best practices. And after they start onboarding and they maybe start creating a schema, now we need to make sure that if they start doing some process that we've seen before in another team, we now can actually have this like glue between the two teams. So now flights and hotels can talk to each other because maybe they're actually doing the same patterns. And maybe we don't have a shared type that they're using right now, but maybe there's a new addition for some new shared type that we can check into the SDK and that would be really helpful for everyone. So schema managers for us has just been a great step to kind of change the culture. And also, we, as the managers, we need to define the rules of the schema. And so we wrote down, one of our big decisions from the start was that we're going to document everything. It's going to be written down in a single location so that all these teams, as they're onboarding, again, and the teams are huge teams of 20, 30 people sometimes, they need to have a single location where they can go and look at what decisions are being made and what that means to use GraphQL at Expedia. But it also just doesn't help the teams that are consuming this documentation. It helps the schema managers ourselves, because I have teammates who work in London or Chicago, and so I'm not always going to be able to make a meeting with someone from India. So if they're going to be doing a meeting with some other teams they're onboarding, we need to make sure we as the schema managers are having a consistent message, that we make sure everyone's doing the same thing. So documentation has been really, really important for us. Another part is that we're doing schema reviews. So we talk with the team, and they know they're good to onboard onto GraphQL. They got on the hype train, and they want to do GraphQL. Let's go. So we make sure we actually meet with them first and say, is your data actually valuable to the schema? Because it might not be. I'll be talking about this just a little bit on the next slide here, but not all the data needs to be in GraphQL, right? You don't need to expose your entire database into your GraphQL schema. And so we want to make sure any data we expose is actually going to be used by the client. And then if we're having the schema review, they've already created the schema. Now we kind of just want to go over the overall structure, make sure they're doing good schema design. And that means that we have a meeting with them, but not just with that team, so not just the schema managers and the team creating the schema. Since we're all contributing to one graph, we actually open up these schema reviews to the entire company. We want the hotels team to be in the meeting with the flights team to say, hey, this is the flight schema, let's review it. Like, you as a hotel contributor or developer, you don't know anything about flights. That's perfect. We want someone who knows nothing about the domain to like propose these questions, like, is this the best design? I don't understand what that field means. And if I, as a developer who work at Expedia, don't know what that field means in flights, how is someone else who's going to be using the schema going to understand it? So you actually bring in people without the domain knowledge to kind of question their decisions. And this kind of creates a community across the whole company too, right? So no longer are just the schema managers in charge of creating this great schema for everyone to use. It's actually everyone's benefit, right? We want everyone to be invested just as we are into making sure we create the best possible schema. And the best possible schema for us actually starts with the clients. So Matt kind of talked about this earlier. You could take a data-first approach, but for us, since we're trying to align on the UI first, everything should be coming from the clients. So that means that the client actually looks at their design, and they create the perfect schema. They have no knowledge of what data is provided, what service capabilities are there. They're just looking at the design and saying, hey, what data does the traveler actually need to book this product, to interact with this product? And then that should be the schema. It has a basic structure. Any data that the customer doesn't see doesn't need to be in the schema. And then from there, you can work with the service teams to adapt the schema to meet the needs. And again, we want to make sure that only the data that's ended up going to be seen by the travelers is exposed in the schema. Yes, GraphQL has this option that clients can select only the fields they need, but we kind of started to question that need if only a single client out of these 50 clients is requesting a field, maybe they shouldn't be using that field, right? Why are they different? Like, what's the point of this data if this only one client is using it? Maybe we can start aligning these clients to actually still use the same fields. Now, you might have some clients, right, like an watch app is not obviously going to show all the same data as your mobile app, so that's where GraphQL can be powerful, but we still want to make sure the data is just the minimal amount of data we need to power a UI. So kind of taking a look at an example, what that might look like. Here's just kind of a mock example of what our hotel's API used to look like on the left side. So it used to return the user data. Yes, the user data was in the API, legacy reasons. And we used to return a list of hotels. So like on a property search, you just get the list of hotels and some user information. And so on the user is logged in or they're not, either authenticated. And then every hotel might have this concept of a member deal. And so not every hotel is available to be have this member deal. So in the schema, if you're an API developer, if you're creating this schema powering this API, what you might do is just say, hey, OK, we're going to simplify this. So no longer does the client have to check two booleans to say, hey, if the user is logged in and this hotel is available for member pricing, then we're going to show some element on the UI. We're going to simplify that into just one check. So we'll do the business logic beyond on the server, less business logic on the client. So we'll just rename it to single boolean, display the member only badge. Great, that seems like it's a benefit for the client. However, if we take a look at the client actually knows that there is another concept of something that we might show to the user. So on the top here is this yellow badge, the members save more, just that's the member-only deal badge. But this other hotel has this concept of a shortage badge, or there's only eight rooms left at this hotel, so we're going to offer you a discount. But the client knows which priority do you show them. They're in the same location. So which badge takes priority if the member deal is there, but it also has a shortage? Well, right now, the client has that business logic. And if they still have to do this check to do these different things, if one client is doing that check, every single client that's using the schema has to also do that check. And that's business logic we're trying to remove from our clients. So instead, we just have this idea of like an offer badge. Which just means that the client just looks at that badge. It might be null, but if it's there, they just take the icon and the text and they put it on the screen. And then in the server, we can define the business logic of what takes priority order. And yes, this is a fairly UI-heavy example, but really this just is the concept that you're trying to reduce the business logic on the client. So you can apply this to any GraphQL schema. All right, so just kind of, if you were to take anything away from this talk, the three things that we found valuable at Expedia Group when doing our GraphQL migration was that we wanted to standardize the tooling to meet our developer needs. The developer experience is going to be key when you're using GraphQL. GraphQL doesn't directly benefit your customers, right? The customer doesn't care if you use GraphQL or if you use REST. The data just shows up to the customer. But GraphQL builds these better developer experiences, as we've seen with some of the client tooling, some of the server tooling. And if your developers work better, then they can build features faster, which benefits your customers. So in the end, we're still making sure that everything works for the developers to help our customers. And making sure that we build a client-first schema. We want the schema to be designed well and making sure it's powered for clients. And then creating a community around that schema creation has been just invaluable for us. Just the amount of communication we have to do with teams and emails and Slack channels, it's too much for a single team of schema managers to handle. So we really are trying to strive for this community of GraphQL at the company. And then lastly, for us, GraphQL has not just been this way to standardize the data. It's been a way for us to standardize our business. All right, so no longer do we have the question of like the hotel's team has this API and they have this data, they have this UI. For us, now it's just the client say, I have this graph and I want to answer these questions that the traveler has, like what hotels are available near the Space Needle? What hotels are available in the customer's cart? These are just questions that your travelers and customers need to know, and it should be just up to the graph to answer them. And it doesn't matter how you change the services underneath that graph, you're just trying to still create a better experience for your customers. All right, so that's all I have today. If you want to follow Expedia Group, you can follow us on social media. We can definitely keep up with our GraphQL journey. I'll be posting more publicly about GraphQL and how we're using it at Expedia. We also have our careers page down here. If you want to follow me on social media, I'm just at Shane Myrick everywhere. Here's some links, and thanks, everyone.